dear God. We ask you, Lord, to touch the ones, Lord. There's problems going on in their life. Because, Lord, you say, I can take care of all circumstances. There is nothing too big for you, Lord. Because we know you got power, Lord. We know, Lord, that we just got a little bit of faith. A little bit of faith, Lord. You say that you will come in, Lord, and just make the crooked place straight. We thank you, God, today. We thank you, Lord. And Lord, all the ones, Lord, got a contrite spirit right now, Lord. We ask you to release it in the name of Jesus. We ask you to let them break that yoke of bondage right now, Lord. Right now, Lord. Right now, Lord. Right now, Lord. Let us come into unity on one accord, Lord. In the name of Jesus. We thank you, God. Because we know that you are our shepherd. And we shall not want, Lord. We shall not want for anything. Whatever we ask for, Lord, you say you would give it to us, Lord. All we got to do is keep your commandment. All we got to do is ask in faith and believe with no doubt. And you shall do it, Lord. We thank you, God. Even the one that's sick right now, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to touch them, Lord. Touch them, Lord, in a mighty way, Lord. Let them know the doctor might have the medicine, Lord, but you got the power. Without your increase, there is nothing. Without your increase, there is nothing. But with your increase, Lord, you got the power. We thank you, God, this morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We didn't have to wake up. We didn't have to wake up, Lord. We didn't have to wake up. I know some didn't wake up this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, I had a classmate, didn't wake up this morning. But God, I hope that she's with you right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, all the one that's there, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to touch their hearts, their mind, and their soul, Lord. Where they can just latch on to you, Lord. Just cling on to you, Lord. Just go come up under your wings, Lord. Where they can take refuge right now. Lord, touch this church right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, we don't want to do it. Lord, we want you to do it, Lord. Because you're a sovereign God. You over everything. All we got to do is say, Lord, let there be light. And there was light. There was light in a very dark place. And we thank you, God, this morning, Lord. We thank you and we worship you. And we give you all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name, I want everybody to say amen.
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 Amen. Chapter 12, verse 1 to 10. Is that right? That's right. 2 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 1 to 10. Now, here the page is about to finish up. Verse 1. It is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to vision and revelation of the Lord. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. Whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. God knows. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows how that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Of such an one I will glory. Yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmity. For though I desire glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he exceeds me to be, or that he hear of me, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in my flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffer me, lest I should be exalted above measure. But this thing I besought the Lord Christ, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee,
yes.
For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ might rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, and in persecutions, and in distressions for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. When I
out here, doing some boasting, and a lot of times when we think about someone boasting, we think about it in the negative connotation, person being conceited or all in yourself, and oftentimes that's true. But when we're boasting about what God has done for us,
yeah.
We boast about how far he brought us. When we boast about the goodness of God in our lives, it's called something else in church. We call that a testimony.
Yeah. Hey, come on.
So it's all right that Paul took the time to give his testimony.
Yeah.
But Paul also lets you know the dangers. Boasting about oneself and the danger of becoming conceited or elevating oneself because of your relationship. He wants, Paul's is okay. You know, I'm telling you that, you know, I've been through all this stuff. And you look back in previous chapters in the Bible, and you will see where Paul talks about he's been shipwrecked. He's been beaten. Back in this, actually 2 Corinthians 11, he talks about how he was shipwrecked. How he was beaten by Jews, and he was left in water all night one time, and constant danger of being robbed on his journeys. Talked about all of those things and how God preserved him through it all. So he's boasting about God and God's mercy and God's grace in his life, and how God did just what he said he would do. He would always bring him through. He spoke about glorifying God. So if you read the context of this passage here in 2 Corinthians 12, he's not necessarily boasting about himself, but about the power. The power of God in his life. See, when you start boasting about yourself, one of the dangers, thinking that because of what I've done and because of the things that I've accomplished in my life, because of my ability to get a higher education, my ability to have a certain income, for what I've done, I've built this, I've done this, I've accomplished this in my life, I have certain skills that somehow set me apart from somebody else. When I start thinking about the me, that's a dangerous thing to do. Because now all of a sudden you think that you have a certain degree of entitlement. And that doesn't just snap people in the world. It happens with people in the church. You can look at some of your mega churches and pastor some of your mega churches right on TV, 7 days a week. And again, if you see some of them, and the message is fine. But then sometimes you look a little deeper, you see that air of conceit that says, I've done this. I've done that. You read the articles in the magazines. They want to talk about what they have accomplished, and they want to take pictures in front of their airplanes and this, that, and the other, and talk about all the millions of dollars that they raise in all the mega churches. I'm building this church, and it's going to hold 35,000 and this, that, and the other. They want to talk about what they have done. Again, they think that they have. Sometimes people, when they talk about the me and what I've accomplished, they think about, they believe that they have a sense of entitlement. In order to maintain that, a lot of church folk, what you see them do, they want to strike a deal with God. I know more words than somebody else because I've studied, and so I can go out and I can just tell people how much I know about God. I can quote all the scriptures. I can be a Jack Van Ennepe, and I can memorize so many thousands and thousands of scripture. I can go to church on Sunday. I can give more in the offering than anybody else. I can lead a good life. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I treat everybody nice. I study the word. An exchange God is going to make everything all right for me. And this is what I deserve because I'm a faithful and obedient Christian. And this is what makes me happy. But God doesn't have a, God's purpose is not to make you happy. Mm. That's not his whole purpose. God's purpose is to make you holy.
Yeah. That's it.
And once God accomplishes that in making you holy, then you'll have a true understanding of what happiness is. Mm. Because then you realize it's not dependent upon what I've done in this body. It's not dependent on how much I've been able to attain. It's not dependent upon how big my church is. It's not dependent upon how much I got in my bank account. It's not dependent upon the degrees on my wall. I'm wholly and solely dependent upon what God has done for me. God places things in our lives. He gives us the tools to make us holy. Mm-hmm. He places things in our lives to help us get to that point. He places people in our lives because he wants us to have certain relationships with people that will be the instrument for you attaining holiness. He places you in a certain church so that you can hear the word at a certain time. He doesn't want you sometimes to be in the mega church where you get lost and don't have any sense of responsibility. He wants you right here where he knows that you'll be forced to work and do something to glorify him. He'll place certain people in your life that he wants you to have an intimate relationship with that will result in a marriage because he said, this is the person that I have for you. And this is the thing that's going to promote your life and to make you holy. But God is not opposed to you being happy at all. He just wants to make sure that the happiness that you attain in this life comes through him. That's all. Some people say, well, I'd be happy if I can build this house that I've been dreaming about all my life. And I can put everything in this house that I want, and you attain that goal. You build this house, and it's the best in the city. It's the biggest and the best. The grounds are immaculate. Inside, it's beautiful. Outside, people just ride by to adore it. And you call it a blessing. And it can be a blessing. But if God is not on the inside of that house, I guarantee you when you walk through the door instead of a blessing, you're going to find drama. You're going to find a big house full of drama. Hmm. And you're going to break your neck when you come in the front door trying to get out the back. Mm-hmm. Because you can't take the drama. Amen. That's on the inside. But when God is in the plane,
yes,
you don't have to worry about whether or not there's happiness in the house, in the home. There's happiness in the home when you put God in the home first. Right. When you tell God to unlock the door and walk, take the first step and bless his home. Yes.
Amen.
When it comes through him,
yes,
when it comes through him, you will have happiness. But most of all, you're going to have holiness. Just because you don't have what someone else has
just because you don't think you have what you deserve, God has not forgotten you, punished you, deprived you, and you are not outside of his will. But we know this because we know that Paul himself, though he may not have always been a godly man, he was a godly man. He was a faithful man, and he was obedient. There became a time when he became obedient to God. But even after this, even after he followed God, his life was still full of turmoil. And I referenced earlier, referenced 2 Corinthians 11, verses 23 through 27, when Paul talked about his suffering, when he talked about being imprisoned, when he talked about being beaten several times, he talked about being stoned and being in three shipwrecks, being left in the water from daylight, from night to day, in constant danger as he walked and journeyed for God, from being robbed on the road. Paul talked about all these things, yet he was a faithful and godly man. And you say, why would these things, why would God allow all of these things to happen to somebody who claims to be obedient to me, who's faithful to me, who claims to be strong in my word? And Paul was speaking about his suffering. He was imprisoned and beaten, but all these things happened to Paul not because he was outside of the will of God, but because he was in it. That's what you have to understand. When everything doesn't happen the way you want it to happen, when you don't have all the things and do all to make all the accomplishments in life that you think you should make, then that doesn't mean that you're outside of God's will. It could be because you're in it. God allowed these things to happen to Paul so that he could mold his character. He could mold his character so when Paul faced adversity, he knew who he had to turn to. He knew the one that he had to depend on. When all these things happen in your life, God let them happen for a reason. Not because God wants to see you fail, but because God wants to mold your character so when trouble comes, when the hard time comes, you don't have to worry. You can say, I'm leaning and depending on God. My happiness is not dependent upon my bank account. My happiness is not dependent upon my degrees on the wall. My happiness is not dependent on the size of my house. My happiness is dependent upon the God in me. You have to live your life for Christ. No matter what you're going through. In this life, there's going to be some hard times. There's going to be some good times. And I don't care how many times a day that you go down on your knees. How loud you shout praises to God. Sometimes in this life, there's going to be adversity. Sometimes in this life, it's going to be some bad times. And not because you're outside of God's will. But God is trying to mold you. When I think about the scripture about the wheel, molding on the wheel, in the pottery house. I remember kids, we used to love to go to Williamsburg, Virginia. And they had a pottery house. And the lady had the old spinning wheel. And to show you the old-fashioned way, you used to put the clay on there. And just like a lump of clay, that's all it was, a lump of clay, and it was being moisturized by water, and she was molding it. And you couldn't tell what it was going to be at first, but if you sat there and you watched, you saw it coming into a formation. Sometimes it would be a vase, sometimes it would be a bowl. You never knew in the beginning, but as you watched, and you watched, and you watched her hands molding and making, it became something useful, something that somebody can use in a home to make the home better. And that's how it is with Jesus. Sometimes you go through hard times, but you're just like that lump of clay. God is just molding you, and nobody can tell what you're going to be right away. But when you just let it work on you, just let it work on you and mold you, after a while you become a beautiful vessel for the Lord. After a while, everybody can see what God has done. And you can look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm a beautiful vessel. Look what God has done for me. He did it because I was willing to put me aside. He did it because I was willing to say, I'm not going to be the conceited one. He did it because I was able to let him work in my life and make out of me that he saw was useful for his kingdom. Despite Paul's many hardships, Paul held on fast to Christ.
He held on to his faith. Most people, when they see themselves going through hard times, they quit. And the devil's in your ear saying, you know, God's supposed to bless you. You're not supposed to be going through this. You're not supposed to be doing this. I thought you said your God was merciful. I thought you said your God was holy. I thought you said that your God made you happy. I thought you said all these things, these wonderful things about your God. But just look at you. Look at Paul. Read your Bible. Was Paul all that in tune with God? He claimed to be faithful to God. He loved God. If God put a thorn in his side that he could hardly bear, we don't know what that thorn was, but it had to be something terrible. We know that God put it there and Paul could not get rid of it. Was the devil will tell you, is that what God does for you? Is that what a merciful God is all about? You should just tell him, if that's all it is in this life for me, no thank you. But Paul rightfully considered the thorn in his side a weakness. Like I said, the scripture doesn't tell us whether it was physical, whether it was spiritual. But I do believe that Paul knew that it was something that God had allowed to happen. See, sometimes when we get sick, and we don't know what the diagnosis, we don't know what the true diagnosis is, and if we do know, we don't know what the cure is. That's our thorn in the side. And sometimes that can, when you pray and you pray and you pray, that can cause your faith to waver. Sometimes we have a financial thorn. The man is posted a notice on the door says foreclosure. And you don't know where your next dollar is coming from. That can be your thorn in your side. But through it all, Paul held on to Jesus. Sometimes when you're going through it all, you have to learn to trust in Jesus.
Yeah.
Andre Crouch said you have to learn to trust in God. Amen. Through it all,
yeah,
I've learned to depend upon his word. That's what Andre Crouch said. It rings true that sometimes the only thing that you can turn to is, God, I've done all I can do. I'm at the end of myself. I can't go any further. I don't have the knowledge or the strength to figure this thing out. God, I'm wholly dependent upon you. The devil will tell you to just go ahead and give up. Boy, just go ahead and climb the highest mountain you can climb, jump off, and let it be over. But God has said, just hold on to my unchanging hand. Sometimes when your body starts to deteriorate from that sickness, God is saying, just hold on. It won't last forever. I'm right here. I said in my word many times before that I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. I said in my word many times that I was the great doctor and I'll pull you through. Just hold on to my unchanging hand. Boy, what I want you to know is what I'm doing right now, I'm just molding you. I'm not finished molding you yet. Sometimes you jump off the wheel before I complete the task, and you're not turning out to be what I want you to be. So I had to put you back on the wheel and remold you until I get what I want out of you. Sometimes God has to do that for us. But we just have to trust God that we're going to be that vessel that he wants us to be. Sometimes it's the devil. But whatever the devil means for bad, God has a counter plan. He said, yeah, Ronnie can't see your plan right now, but I knew it from the beginning. And I'm going to mold him into something good. I just want Ronnie to stay humble. And that's what Paul had to do. In the good times, God tells us in this scripture here, in the good times, when I'm blessing you, it's not because you deserved it, because I love you.
Amen.
But I want you to stay humble.
Yes.
I didn't give you all these things that you have so you can go out and boast about what you've done.
Amen.
I did it because I think that you're responsible. Amen. I think that you can handle it. But I want you to remain humble. And even when the things don't last and everything starts to deteriorate and everything starts to go bad in your life,
Don't worry, I'm still here. I still want you to still be that same old humble person that you were in the good times. I want you to be that humble person in the bad times. I'm still molding you. And you, maybe it's time to mold you into something else. I've used you, and you were a good vessel. You served your purpose. But now maybe I need to soften the clay, and now I need to make you into something else, something useful for somebody else's well-being. So God sometimes just wants us to remain humble through the good times and the bad times, through hardship, through sickness, just when you're losing a child, when your child is on drugs and you think you can't bear it, don't worry about it. Yeah. God has a plan. Just stay faithful to Him.
Yes, yes.
Paul prayed for that. For that thorn to be removed. But God said no. God said no. He said, I don't want you to worry about that thorn.
Amen.
Don't worry about it.
Yes.
I'm telling you no. But understand this, my grace
yes.
is sufficient. God was telling Paul, you never gonna be perfect in this flesh. It's gonna get old, and before it get old, it's gonna hurt sometimes. But that is why he's letting Paul know, but that's why I have you, just have you have this thorn to remind you of my grace. And that even if you carry this thorn, you still do my will, because my grace is sufficient. It's not going to stop you from praising me. Don't let it stop you from worshiping me.
Yes.
You're not the only one that ever carried a burden. You're going to carry burdens in this life.
Yeah.
But you have to keep on keeping on. You have to keep on looking up to God.
Yes.
Because God sometimes wants your burden to be an example for somebody else who wants to give up.
Yes.
Somebody else who's not going to have your strength. And say, boy, if I was going through all that, I don't know how I was going to make it. But when I look at Steve, and he has that burden on his back, and he's still praising God, there must be something to the God thing. So guess what? I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to surrender. I'm going to surrender because I want the happiness that he has. The happiness that he has through controversy. The happiness that he has through all of the pain. The happiness that he has through all of his suffering. If he can still have happiness through all of that, it must not be about what he attained, but it must be about God. God wants you to recognize that when you reach your weakest point and there's nowhere else to turn, that you need Him.
Amen.
He wants you to recognize that you need Him.
Yes.
And that through that, His grace is sufficient. And that your strength is made perfect in weakness. That's how we know. Well, strength is not how much you can go in the gym and lift. That's not a determination of how strong you are. But when you're in your weakest moment and you still have God, I'm leaning, I'm dependent on God and nobody else. I'm at my weakest moment, at the end of myself. I don't know what to do. I can't do anything else. When I reach that point, my strength is my faith. My strength is my faith in believing that God will bring me through. His promises have always been kept in my life. And I know that He'll bring me through. So God is telling me, don't worry about all your heartaches. Don't you worry about anything. You just humble yourself so that the power, my power, can dwell in you. But only when you humble yourself, because when you can't surrender until you humble yourself.
Amen.
Because you, when you humble yourself, you're saying, God, take over.
Yeah.
God, I'm taking over, humble myself. It's not about me. It's all about
yes.
you. And now when you humble yourself, you open up and God can come in into your heart. Paul said, I take pleasure in my infirmities. He said, for Christ's sake, because when I'm weak, I'm strong. So when you're angry because because of all you work for in this life, doesn't mount up to what you think it should equal. It doesn't equal all of the bank accounts. It doesn't equal all of the accolades coming from other people. It doesn't equal all of the things that you think you should have acquired at this point. Then when you need to change your heart. You need to change your heart and be content in this weak stage that you're in. You need to know that God is always looking after you. You see, you can't always change your circumstances. You can't always do that. But you can always change your attitude. Mm-hmm. You can always, that's one thing you're going to always have control of. And that's your attitude. Whether I choose to praise him or whether I choose to ignore him. And I'm telling you now, don't ignore him. You're going to have a thorn. It may not manifest itself today, but it's going to manifest itself at some point in your life. And you're not going to recognize it right away until you come back and have the remembrance of God's word. This is something that I can't handle. God, you put me in a situation that I don't